numbers going to stay the same. What makes it more challenging for all of us in this room, and as you articulated, the names can change. They can change the name, they can change the flag, and some of those happen, you know, very quickly. Keeping the RFMO list updated is a challenge. But you'll see many of the RFMO lists actually have the vessel's current name and previous names. We'll talk a bit, I think I've mentioned, we've talked a little bit, the STS-50, which was apprehended by Indonesia. I mean, that vessel started out as the Andre Dolgov, turned into the Sea Breeze, then went to the Ida, then turned into Ida with a different spelling, then to STS-50, all within the course of about 6 months, and changed flags multiple times. So part of this goes back to my overarching caveat, international cooperation. We've got to continue to communicate. We've got to let the RFMO know when we board and inspect the vessel. We have to verify the name is correct. We have to verify what the numbers. This is not easy. If there's anybody in here that thought combating IUU fishing was an easy endeavor, then I want to correct that right now. It's not, and it's a long battle. And a lot of times, as the example the Philippines pointed out, it's not that quick apprehension. Sometimes it is, and sometimes you can find a way to do that, but a lot of times it's an ongoing, long-term investigation, international cooperation, trying to find a way, but trying to identify what the vessel is. You're going to occasionally get those. Gee, that vessel, a lot of things aren't the same. A lot of vessels take the same name. May or may not be the IUU vessel. That's what we all have to do. That's the information we have to share. And we do have to go through those exercises of educating others that know it may have the same name, but it's not the IUU vessel because of X, Y, and Z on this. Would Brendan or Joao want to add anything? Oh, sorry.
Go ahead.
Yeah,
we're on standby for Mike.
I guess Todd's exactly right, that it is a big challenge with the RFMOs keeping updated. So the WCPSC is dealing with tens of thousands of boats, so it's a very difficult list to keep updating. But this is what it comes back to, and I'm sure Todd's going to go into more detail about this later, is your risk analysis on whether you inspect the vessel. If you have questions over a vessel, then you would go, all right, that's a high risk, we're going to inspect that vessel. If you can get copies of photos of vessels, everyone's heard the saying, a leopard can't change its spots. A vessel can change its name, it can paint the superstructure, it can paint the hull, but it's very difficult to make huge modifications to a vessel. They won't necessarily change the whole superstructure, they won't necessarily remove cranes off. If you can get a photo of the vessel, no matter how old it is, it's going to be relatively consistent with the photo, a newer photo. So if you go down to the port, you have a photo of it, you're looking at, oh yeah, no, hang on, that vessel looks like, even though it's got a different name, that vessel looks like that vessel that I have in this picture here. And it could be an IU vessel. And Todd will go into far more detail about this, about the different background checks you can do, intel gathering, utilizing the networks you have, all of that. So any information you have, that should go into your risk assessment for whether you are going to conduct an inspection of that vessel.
Thank you. I was going to stress the same points. And a few years ago, we had a situation in the North Atlantic with the cloning of vessel, which we came up, we find out that there were three vessels using exactly the same base information, same IMO number, same name, and so on. And the only reason we were able to, I think it was Norway, to seize the vessel, was exactly because you cannot change the superstructure. So we have two photos. The first thing that happened was we had AIS information that the same vessel was in the North Atlantic and the Indian Ocean at the same time. So that's the first indicator that something was wrong. And then we tried to go a little bit further, and we managed to get photos of an NGO somewhere in Africa a few years back, so we were able to identify the superstructure, as this is not who they claim they are, so this vessel is a different vessel. And because one of those inspections a few years before, because they had illegal activities, the inspection was so complete that they went to the point of registering the engine serial number and the power of the engine, which is the other thing you don't change easily. It's the main engine of the vessel. So in a situation like this, you then have proof enough to show that this vessel is the one that was inspected a few years back in Senegal or Togo or whatever, and then you can prove that there is a series of violation, IUU fishing and so on. Because it's very easy to have several vessels with the same identity or one vessel with multiple identities. That is very, very easy to do.
That fits the cooperation among the armed forces also very important to us, as you said.
Yeah, because I have a vessel which is operating in the Southern Pacific and easily move on to Southern Indian Ocean region also, and also those who operate in the Southern Atlantic can also come over to the Southern Indian Oceans. I don't know whether the mechanism is there to have an intergovernmental cooperation among the armed forces.
Well, most of this exchange of intelligence comes to almost to a personal level. You know, of course, the more you attend these workshops and international fora, the more people you know. So if tomorrow I am in the North Atlantic and there is a vessel that has a species that is from the Indian Ocean, most likely I will call someone I know in IOTC and say, well, is this species regulated by you? Where do they get this? Who should I call? And then this colleague from IOTC will eventually give me a number of an inspector in Seychelles or Sri Lanka or whatever, telling, look, this guy knows about these assets. So call him, and that's the way it works. Much more than a director general sending a letter to another director general. It works almost in a personal level. And quite often you are able to gather intelligence, because this is what it's all about. It sounds very serious, but it's law enforcement like all the other law enforcement techniques. It's about intelligence gathering and sharing.
And not only that, there are contacts for each RFMO. So you can contact the IOTC secretariat. There's an email addresses available. The WCBOC secretariat, at any point you can contact any one of the RFMOs and they will share information to what ability they can about a certain vessel. And then you can go to flag state if you need to.
But you also have to be prepared, because when I was working with one RFMO, I asked a specific question formally by email to another Atlantic RFMO, and the answer was this information is confidential. So you have to be prepared for sometimes some strange reactions. And again, maybe things in the Pacific are now more open and transparent. In the Atlantic, there are still certain issues, let's call it.
Thank you. Any other questions at this stage? Okay. I think that this next section, I'm going to talk a little bit about some vessel information sources. I know Thailand hit on some of it with their presentations yesterday. And I know also for some of you, you may or may not have another entity like the Thailand of Ocean Mind that does their initial risk assessment. For us, we have an analyst team that focuses on doing that risk assessment. Not all of you have that luxury. So a lot of this often will fall to the inspector. So, well, that's challenging. Part of the whole process of risk assessment and some of these sources of information to help you develop that risk is valuable for whether you're an inspector or even someone that has to support the inspectors or is in policy and looking at how you're going to implement PSMA. The inspector's job, and I'll confess, I'm a little partial, but the inspector's job on PSMA is huge. It's a very challenging and can be a very daunting task because there's so much information. And this risk assessment is pretty critical because you can't possibly get down to checking engine numbers per se on every single vessel and verifying every single piece. But in that case, or in the Bangman Percasa, as I mentioned yesterday, that engine serial number was actually a very big piece of how we tried to figure out who the vessel actually was, because those things don't necessarily change. So we've got to evaluate and find sources of information to develop a risk assessment. So when your inspector goes on the vessel, whether he has to do this himself or herself, or whether it's somebody else doing it, you need to know what questions you're going to ask. Because otherwise, you could be on these vessels for days trying to get something done, and you'll never be able to board enough vessels. So we've got to figure out which ones we ask these extra questions on, which ones we do a more cursory inspection, which vessels we may not have to inspect at all. If you have the same vessel coming into your port over and over, and you've boarded it multiple times and never found a violation or a problem, that becomes a low priority inspection unless something new comes up. So that's what we're going to talk a little bit about here. We've hit this. This is what our whole discussion has been for the last 5 minutes. It's this slide, so the perfect lead-in. Thank you for the question, and thank you for the assistance of leading us into this. Go ahead. So, yeah, no. And we've already talked a bit about this, too. But the things I do want to highlight is information from international organizations. So don't forget that there is Interpol out there. There is the ability to work with other countries. There is the ability to go out and ask the flag state for verification. The key is, this is all in that AREP period. Okay? The advantage to getting the information ahead of time is you actually have time to think about it and look at it and figure out what you're going to do when you get on the vessel. Before port state measures, for many of us, you had very little information, and you just went, when you got on the boat, you found out what you found out. And then you get back to the office, and you ask some questions, you're like, oh wow, I wish I had to check this, or I wish I had to check that, because you find out more information. Now we get that information ahead of time. So, some of this, I'm not going to duplicate, so we'll jump over this. Catherine showed some examples of RFMO websites. They're all different. They're in your packets. As far as the RFMO and on the presentation, those RFMO links, so you can look at them yourselves, play with them. Again, if you'd like us to do demonstrations or dig into any of these, we're glad to do that during the course, or do it at a break. But that information can verify what's in your AREP. Okay? And that's what it's really about. Figure out if your AREP is an accurate reflection of what's going on. I'm going to put this, I put this up only because I want you to be aware that they're out there. Okay? There are many non-governmental organizations that are evaluating potential IUU activity, that are developing their own, what they'll call blacklists. I want to be clear, these are not the official IUU list that the Port State Measures Agreement refers to. These would be indicators. And in many cases, they can be built in with some bias. They can also not have all the information. And in all honesty, in some cases, they have better information than I can get from official sources. So be aware that they're out there. This is an example of Greenpeace's pirate fishing blacklist. It also has links to the official blacklist, so it has links to the RFMO websites. Similarly, TrigMat combines all the IUU vessel lists, so you only have one place to go. So, my overarching caveat to all of you goes back to the verify. Ultimately, before you take any action, and this is from a liability and from a national government perspective, you need to ensure that what you're dealing with is, in fact, from the RFMO IUU vessel list. These are good sources, might give you a point in the right direction. Always go back to the RFMO list and just reconfirm it's still on that RFMO vessel list, it's still current, before you take any action based on that listing. Okay? Any questions on that? Everybody good with that? TrigMat.
Yeah, but that is not the case with the RFMOs, because it's all scattered among the RFMOs. This is what I was asking.
Yeah. And there's also, yes, and also the FAO website that Catherine showed is also combined. But again, ultimately, you need to go back to that RFMO lease. These are good easier options, but then once you identify that it's on one of these lists, go back and verify that it's on the actual RFMO IU guest list, because under the agreement, that's what you're acting on, right? You're going to deny port services, and you're going to base it that your country has decided that we're going to deny port services because this is an IUU vessel. You need to make sure it's an IUU vessel, or else there are certain liability issues and international ramifications that you could run into. Okay. Make sense? Everybody good? Good. Okay, you're good. You guys are determined to make me work with this. Y'all appear awake, so that's good. All right, we'll keep going. Gotcha. That's okay. Completely throws me. A different side comes up than I was expecting. So these are the positives of what those international IU vessel lists do. Good resource. They do a good job identifying the high-profile vessels. Clearly, to get on an IU vessel list, I hope everybody's familiar that there is a pretty significant process before a vessel is put on one of these IU vessel lists. I mean, the RFMOs don't just throw a vessel on there. All the members have to review the information, confirm that it meets the standards of an IU vessel by the RFMO, and then actually officially designate it as an IU vessel. Okay, so it does a good job of vetting those pieces to it being warranted to be on the IU vessel list. It does make it difficult for offending parties. There's now a big push for cross-listing. So we'll use the Atlantic, for example. If a vessel is listed in NEAF, it automatically is added to the NAFO list, and vice versa. So that makes it much more difficult because there's more and more of the RFMOs agreeing to just automatic cross-listing. Means if it's on one RFMO list, it becomes on all of them. Under port state measures, though, it doesn't matter. It only has to be on one. Okay? So, and I apologize if I get too basic for some of these, but these are some of things that key to me when I think how complicated this is. Like, there's some pretty basic things, and some really core things that we should all recognize. On one IU vessel list, and it doesn't matter if your country is a party or not, to that RFMO, port state measures, that vessel is now controlled by port state measures.
I have a question. Not sure if it's for you or for FAO. Is there, because obviously the IU list depends on the RFMO, but as I recall, there are about 30 RFMOs in the world. So, is the PSMA based on all of them, or because some of them are quite small, I guess?
Sure, I'll put up a slide that could help.
Yeah, the question is that there is no one non-compliance or IUU list for the moment. As a former inspector, I can tell you that in the beginning, at least in the Atlantic, we all use the Norwegian government one, because once you get into the Norwegian IUU list, you never leave. So, but that, of course, that was 15 years ago. Things now are different. TRIGMAT, it's a very good one, it's combined. But again, it only needs to be in one. In the case of the RFMO where I worked before, NEAF, PNAFO, SIAFO, and there was another one, I'm not sure if it was Camar. We all agreed that once a vessel is one list, it goes automatically in the other list. And as Todd said, it takes a little bit to get in the list. It's just not because there is a process of contacting the flag states or asking questions before it goes in the IU. So there is a due process before it goes to the IU. But again, in many of the RFMOs, again, once you get into the IUU list, it's very difficult to leave the IUU list. Sometimes even when the boat doesn't exist anymore physically, because we don't have documents that certify that the vessel was scrapped, the vessel is still in the IUUs.
To that point too, there are many regional fisheries bodies that are not full-fledged regional fishery management organizations. So not all regional fisheries bodies have IUU lists. So currently, these are the ones that do. So you're not looking at the 30 RFBs, it's looking at these. But to Joao's point on the consolidated list, we have provided the FAO one, the NGOs that have tried to do this. But when you are going from RFMO to RFMO, these are the ones that currently have IU vessel lists, and some of these don't have vessels listed yet.
So I actually picked up on a little bit of a nuance, I think, in your question, but I'm not sure that we've answered, and I'm going to ask my colleagues in the back to help me with this if I get this wrong. But remember that the Port State Managers Agreement says IUU fishing or evidence or suspicion of IUU fishing. By de facto, we refer to the RFMO IUU vessels because by default, those are automatically sufficient justification under the agreement that it's IUU fishing. But the suspicion piece can also lead to denial of port services, denial of port access, and that suspicion could be even if it's on an interim. For example, many of the RFMOs may put an interim list forward before their annual meeting, before they actually approve it for the IUU vessels. Those vessels, too, should be considered under the agreement as, now those are clearly suspected of IUU fishing. So the many bodies, once it's on an official RFMO IUU vessel list, it's covered by the agreement. And if it's on another interim list or some other list, there may be suspicion that you have to actually board the vessel and confirm yes or no. Is that, or you guys good with that? Okay. Did that answer your question? Have we covered it? Excellent. It's almost lunchtime, so hang in there. You've got 15 more minutes. Everybody good? Look at that. So, some of the challenges we have with IU vessel lists to think about is relatively small, which in many ways is a good thing. That means maybe there's not as much IU fishing as we hope out there, or we think out there. But I'm not sure that may be wishful thinking, because, for example, you've got over 2 million fishing vessels around the world. And there's currently somewhere in the vicinity of 250 total identified or listed IUU vessels. So, in the scheme of things, it's a little bit of a challenge whether they're actually on the list, and again, makes the inspector's job that much more challenging to find any additional evidence. The other thing to remember with RFMOs is some of them are consensus-based. Actually, most of them are consensus-based, so the fact that you've got to get all members, and I've witnessed firsthand what I personally believe, or and most members believe, to be clear IU fishing simply blocked by the flag state. We talked about this before, and I think we're going to continue to talk about it. I'm not going to focus on it more here, but clearly challenges. Trying to get at the actual information, get it through shell companies, through trying to get back to the beneficial ownership, that is our real challenge. We're doing a good job cooperating and interdicting IUU vessels lately, in particular, the last few years. But what we're not necessarily doing as well at, in my opinion, and what is falling a lot on the Port State Measures Agreement and our more thorough inspections and information sharing, is we've got to get to these beneficial owners or these organizations that are profiting from the illegal activity, because it's unlikely to be the crew on that seized vessel that's actually reaping the benefit of driving the operation. So that becomes some of the challenge that we're going to talk about as we get into some of the information analysis. In your folders, you have example sources of verifying and validating information. You will be very happy to hear that I am not going to walk through each and every one of these and talk at you about them. It's a resource for you. There's a lengthy list. of websites and what the information is provided that we hope will be useful to you. We'll hit a couple highlights on the screen that actually will have the hyperlinks when you get the presentation. But it's just to tell you that there's a lot of sources of information out there. You don't need to, nor should you be intimidated by the fact that, oh my God, I have to check all of these different websites when I have a vessel coming into my port. Absolutely not. You may use one of them, you may use 10 of them, you may not use the same ones each time. This is just give you some information that there are websites out there, there are sources out there that we found to be useful and reliable for the inspector or for those doing the risk assessment.
Just one point to that. Our analyst team have tried to highlight what the main uses are for each, as well as some limitations that could be possible. Most of these are open sources. You might have to create an account, but all it is an email address and a password. Some of them are fee-for-service websites. So depending on resources, access might be a problem. So this is just a resource guide to show you what this universe perhaps looks like. And it contains both open sources as well as fee-for-services that you would have to pay for the subscription.
And one thing I would ask of all of you as we use this as the start of our collaboration and cooperation, if you use these resources and find that we're way off track and it's not useful, or you find different advantages or disadvantages, please share those back with us. Because the goal is for us to develop tools together that work. This is not our tools. This is what our analyst team thought might be useful. Please feel free to let us know if they're completely unuseful for you, or if you have other suggestions and other feedback, okay? Good. And I'm not going to go through all of these sources. Like I said, there's lots of different options. The advantage with the Port State Measures Agreement is that AREP. The AREP contains a wealth of information about the vessel and what it's telling you that it's been doing. Okay? Remember, that's the key piece. The AREP is simply the vessel telling you, in some cases, just what you want to hear. And in other cases, completely factual, what the vessel is doing. It's the challenge is figuring out which is which and verifying that the information you're getting is accurate so that you can decide how thorough a boarding inspection is required, how high is the risk that this vessel is an IMU vessel. Let's go with the video only because I sense that I'm losing it. Because they have to listen to me. I had to change. Who's going to do karaoke after? We'll do the next session of karaoke. Who's up? No one? Oh, come on. I know there's somebody here that like karaoke. Maybe we'll ask Steve if they can get a karaoke machine for after, and we'll do the next session. No one. Absolutely not. All right, so this video clip will entertain you a little before we break for lunch. We'll finish up the sources after lunch. This clip is from the Lord of War. Lords of War? Yeah. Lords of War? Lord of War. Okay, so some of you are familiar with it. It is not specifically IUU fishing. However, it seems very apropos for the situation that we find ourselves in, because I have actually been aware of vessels that do very similar things as a Coast Guard plane overflies them, and we see similar activity on what we suspect are IU vessels. And if we saw this activity, we would likely be confirmed that it was IU activity, because there's no other reason. But anyway, it's a little entertaining. I think it's a clean, we've removed some of the Hollywoodish pieces, but we'll go with it.
It is a movie, so there is Hollywood. We are pretty confident there are no explicit language, that we censored all that, but apologies if one escapes. And it highlights a lot of the discussions that we've talked about with vessel name changes and things like that. Hopefully not too bad.
There are three basic types of arms.
It's a good lead into lunch period.
There are three basic types of arms: white being legal, black being illegal, and my personal favorite color, gray. Sometimes I made the deal so convoluted, it was hard for me to work out if they were on the level. Keep authorities in the dark, I often spoke in code. Rocket launchers were mothers, the rockets, children. The AK-47 assault rifle was the Angel King.
The jury. Raul. The Angel King will arrive tomorrow. Hallelujah to you too.
The point is, if I've done my job right, an arms embargo should be practically impossible to enforce.
What? Okay, slow them down. I can't understand you. What? What do you mean tipped off? And where we are? And where are they? Well, how long have I got? Not long? What does that mean?
We're trying to lose him.
On this?
No, we have to get off the set.
No, no one's going anywhere. Slow. Dead slow. Why are you trying? Yeah, sure. Get that thing right down. I need another handle for this car. Something in our weight class. You, over the side. We're changing the name. Now! Yes, time to check out.
The way I look at it, what's in the name?
Have you got a shorter name?
I'd often change the registration of a ship or a plane, but never except short notice.
What? Kono, how do you spell that? K-O-N-O. Well, that's good. Kono. K-O-N-O. What are we flying? Dutch Dug.
You've got to be Dutch Dug.
So just a little bit of entertainment for you, but some of that was pretty real. Okay, if you think about, we've actually seen vessels that were changing their names when they were overflown by a U.S. Coast Guard aircraft, high seas drift net, literally changing their name while the plane went over the top. Tarps hanging over the side covering the vessel's name. What are some of the things you come up on a vessel? That vessel comes into port. Anything there you find suspicious if you boarded that vessel and it was potentially an IU fishing vessel? What do you see? Paint? Paint? Fresh paint, because even Kono didn't look quite well painted on the stern there, so that certainly would be an indicator. Okay? Paint? Anything else?
Sure.
I think the biggest indicator, there is a guy with a suit and a tie on board. I would
well,
be
that
very
certainly
suspicious.
Is definitely.
I would be very suspicious if I, before boarding, I look up and there is a guy with a suit.
You might have found a beneficial owner.
Yes.
How about you're checking the vessel and you find an entire slew of different countries' flags? Yeah, you should have one flag, right? shouldn't have need for several others. Okay? The whole, on the stern, just having a Jacob's ladder, or however you want to term it, like hanging over the side where they could have painted the name. Unfortunately, this cut off a little too soon, but one of the things on the next part of the scene is they're getting boarded by the team, is they walk past one of the life rings that says Crystal on the side of it. So, you know, you have to quick and run back and turn it around. But it's funny, but it's actually things that you need to do, and what we're going to pitch for the rest of our training for inspectors, dig a little deeper. Pay attention. Observe. Things that are inconsistent are the key. So, the name seems, paint scheme doesn't match. All of a sudden, it's a darker block across the back of black, and then some, not some clear white lettering. Maybe that's a problem. The name on the life ring doesn't match the name on the vessel. Whole bunch of different flags sitting in a hole. Different documents sitting on the bridge with different names. A lot of things that somebody could easily look over or look past, but trying to get all of you to be aware that that's how we're going to get at these true IUU vessels. Is they're the ones that are intentionally playing the game, they're counting on us to not talk to each other, they're counting us to not do our homework and check things before the vessel comes in, and they're expecting that you're not going to pick up on inconsistencies. But you can only lie so many times, so if they're trying to change the identity of a vessel, something could very well be messed up. A logbook that has a different name on it, even the engine room log. There could be a legitimate name change, but things that you should start to think of. But anyway, whoops, go ahead.
We assisted with the boarding in Peru, and the vessel in question there still had all of the boxes that you would put the fish product in with the previous vessel's name on it. So a lot of times there's receipts, there is package, they literally had the packaging with the old name on it.
Yeah. And it could have been a legitimate name change. Vessels do actually legitimately change their name and change their flag. But those are all things that we're asking you to start paying more attention to. Things that just don't match. The challenge of some of these is they are expensive. Okay, so the Lloyd's subscription to get full access to all of the information available in Lloyd's, it can get expensive. What we've found, we can limit the number of subscriptions. You can get together with other agencies. So like we've used it in our commercial targeting analysis center, which is 11 different federal agencies working together. They have subscriptions, so as a group, you can get it, but it can be cost prohibitive, but it is very good information. So here's just a couple examples, and again, I'm not gonna walk through all the examples, but I wanted to just highlight to you that there's a lot of information out there. In this case, actually Russia and Korea are two that have good websites that provide information on their flagged vessels. I was not aware of this. Our analysts did some searching. The dilemma with most of these is a lot of nations don't do it this way. So most nations, you're not going to be able to find their vessel registries online. Hopefully the global record will start to solve some of that. But in the interim, these are a couple examples.
We're also seeing a lot of regional organizations to combat IUU fishing that are starting to publish their vessel registries for public information. For example, in Latin America, there is a network for deterring, eliminating, preventing IUU fishing, and it's an online system. Currently, there are limited members to that, but it does cover countries like Chile, Ecuador, Peru, Panama, I believe. I will double check that at the break. Costa Rica and some others. So as these regional websites get developed for sharing of vessel information, it's just good to know what's going on in other parts of the world. For example, yesterday from Thailand, we heard that the majority of their carrier vessels are Panamanian. So if that information, that registry is available elsewhere. So just we're all trying to work together within our own regional networks and things like that, but looking at the more global picture too.
So So this is an example of Marine Traffic, another website that talks about, they can give you vessel information, provide some AIS information, but this is the type of information that it'll provide. So again, as was mentioned this morning, it's nice to have that picture. So pictures of vessels, even as they change names, can be very useful for an inspector perspective, particularly if you're doing your risk assessment. Gee, is this the vessel that it claims to be? If it doesn't match when you walk up to the vessel, that's a whole, you know, different alert for you as the inspector. So some of the advantages for some of these commercial AIS sites, in particular, when you're dealing with getting AIS information, they're generally free. That's a good identifier, goes along with the IMO numbers. But the challenge, as we talked about with AIS, and as was demonstrated in Thailand's presentation yesterday, AIS can be turned off. It's not a secure system. It's an indicator, is how we use it. We don't use AIS as particularly a law enforcement tool. It's an indicator, helps us get some information, but it's not generally where we will rely on, because the information is controlled by the operator. They enter who they are, they enter where they are, and as we learn, spoofing, we've seen vessels show up in multiple oceans at the same time. Clearly, they're not in multiple oceans at the same time. So. Because I was going to ask you to teach it. No? Okay. Refresher for you, maybe something new for the rest of you. The interesting thing, is everybody here good at math? No, you're not. That's true. So, get your phone out, and there's a calculator on it. So, you may want to actually, I'm serious, if you're not good at longhand math and multiplication, grab your phone, because you'll be able to see this exercise. And this works actually very well, at least as an indicator of whether an IMO number is a legitimate number. So if somebody's making up their vessel name or giving you false information, it's conceivable, and we have seen incidents where they'll make up an IMO number and just throw it at you. There is a way to verify if it's a legitimate IMO number. So the last number, the last number in an IMO number is considered its control number. Okay, so there's actually a method to the madness of how these numbers are assigned and designated. So that last digit is what they call the control number. I'm going to try to walk through this slow, but please stop me if it doesn't make sense. This is a quick way for an inspector or anyone looking at an IMO number to determine if it's a legitimate number. This doesn't mean that it goes to the vessel you're looking at, per se, but it's a quick read. If it's a false number, then you've got something you need to start looking into, or there's an error in transposing, any other number of other things. But when you look at the IMO number, you look at the control number, the last digit, as in the first place of the number. Okay, you look at the IMO number effectively backwards. So that's position number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. Okay? Nice. You can do this all the way through? So, it is. So, in this case, actually, I want to go to the next slide, it's a little easier. So, to find out if your number is a legitimate number, again, you're looking at 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7 of the positions, okay? So, starting at the beginning of the number, you take this one, the 9 times 7, plus 0 times 6, plus 7 times 5, and then so on. So this one, 4 times 4, 7 times 3, and 1 times 2. Does everybody follow how I'm doing that? Okay, but some, maybe a couple notes. Now I may have to do it. So, yeah, okay. So when you're looking at the number, the important thing is just the positions. So if you go from left to right, right to left, right to left, that first digit is your control number. Okay, so that's the one you're going to be working towards. So this is in the second position of the number, the third, the fourth, the fifth, the sixth, and the seventh. Okay, because the iron number is seven digits. Okay, so just a matter of positioning. So you're working back the other way. Now go to the next one. And all you're doing is you're taking the position number times the number in that position. And then you're going to add them up. So in this case, you start with, oh, that was weird. 7 times 9 plus 6 times 0 plus 7 times 5, 4 times 4, then you get 7 times 3, it's in the third position, and then the 1 times 2, and then you add those up. And in this scenario, what that actually adds up to, if you go 9 times 7, 0 times 6, 7 times 5, 4 times 4, 7 times 3, and 1 times 2, if you add those up, it comes up to 137. Your control number is 9. Okay. So you compare the last digit of the INO number to the last digit of the sum, and if they don't match, it is not a legitimate INO number.
No matter what, if we calculate opposite from, start from 1 multiplied by 2, and then start from 1 multiplied by 2 first, and then...
Oh, I don't think the order matters.
As long as you're multiplying the position. Right. It's the position of the number times the number in that position. And so, yeah, theoretically, you could go the other way. You're right. Because the sum would still be the same. But in this case, it's a relatively quick way to say, yeah, I don't have a legitimate IMO number, so now I should be a little concerned, okay? My concern level comes up a notch. Because there are things that maybe they typed it wrong. Maybe, I mean, one digit's off, I mean, who knows? Or they simply made up an IMO number, they threw a seven-digit number at you with a name and hoped you wouldn't check. This is a quick way for an inspector or someone doing risk assessment to just verify whether it's a legitimate number or not. It's only one step. Remember, they could pick a legitimate IMO number and attach it to a bogus vessel name and still be IU. But this is something that we found, some inspectors have found to be useful. At least they know if there's somebody sending in their AREP a false number or trying to make up an IMO number, at least you'll be able to detect it. Does that make sense to everybody? Want to try a legitimate number?
I can go look out the window.
I was going to say, I bet the...
I'm checking the NEAF.
Oh!
Joao
is going to help us.
Do you have the number
us.
Off the Mahedo?
Just, all right, somebody, anybody, grab an IMO number for us.
I'll yell one out.
Hold on.
I'll yell one out. Everyone write this number down.
Write this down, everybody.
Write this number down. All right, so 73. Oh, hang on. All right. Have we got one?
9015840. I don't think so. For the Cherry Star, it's 9015840. That means I have to do math.
This is not going to work.
For a quick point to Cambodia's question, the key thing, I don't think which way you do this matters. The key part is understanding that your control number is in position one. You're never using this number, okay? That's the key. Is this is number one, so the position numbers have to go that way.
Nine, zero, one, five, eight, four, zero.
Yeah, the trumpet is going to be better to take the problem as well.
So, I think we've already got an answer. So what's the check number?
120
is the word. Does everybody agree with that? Thumbs up, thumbs down. 120. Did everybody get 120? Well, 120 is the total. And the last digit is 0. The last digit, the control number of the IMO number is 0. At least on the surface, this would be a legitimate IMO number. Okay? Well, I was really hoping it turned out to be a good IMO number, because that would have been very, very upsetting if we had a bad IMO number. Because then you'd have to say, I think Kyle and I said you failed on yesterday because you didn't pick up on that. Sure. So just, even though everybody said they got 120, we're going to walk through it and make sure that I would have gotten to 120. And if I need remedial training, you all will have to teach me. So remember, our control number's here. So, So this is position two. You have to go one way or the other. Oh, okay. All right. So what did you multiply 9 by?
7.
Okay. How about the 0?
6.
What about the 8?
What did you multiply the 8 by?
3.
I see what you're trying to do.
What about the
4?
2.
What about the
0?
That's right. We don't use the control number and multiply it by anything. You guys got this.
Everybody see how we do that though?
Well, did you add it up?
No, I trust their math, not mine.
Oh.
I don't have a calculator.
So 63.
Oh, I did that.
That's all we need you to do.
0, 5, 20, 8.
And all that adds up to? 120. Check number 0, the last digit is 0, check number is 0, they match. Excellent. Okay. So now we're jumping over to some indicators of MMSI numbers. So, and there are likely more of you in this room that are more experienced in MIMSI or MMSI numbers than I. But in general, you'll see that there are prefixes based on regions and countries. So again, there's another set of numbers that mean something. It's not just a bunch of digits. So for example, Europe is typically, we'll start with 2, so 247 could legitimately be, I mean that's Italy. So the 2 indicates it's from Europe, okay? 3 is North and Central America and the Caribbean. An example there is Canada, MIMSI could be 316. 4, so a lot of them here, you might see MIMSIs that begin with 4. So Asia, and it China, you have 412, 413, and 414. That would be the beginning digits of the MIMSI, indicating that vessel as Chinese. Oceania being 5, New Zealand 512. Africa being 6. This shows my lack of geography because...
Etria.
I have no idea where that is. It's clearly in Africa, and I apologize for not knowing where that is. 625. And South America begins with 7, so Peru, for example, is 760. So all these numbers that get thrown at you, they actually have some method to the madness. And they're not just random numbers thrown out there. There's a meaning to several of them. So it's good to try to learn some of these tricks. Yeah, you don't have to memorize them, but to know that these exist and, gee, I've got a Mimsy from, they're coming from North America, and yet it starts with a 5. Well, that doesn't make sense, because a North American vessel should, the Mimsy should start with 3, right? So just little things to look at, to consider as an inspector or as someone that's trying to help inspectors or design programs, procedures to implement port safe measures. Just another piece. Anything from my colleagues in the back on that? We're good? Okay. So all of this, the reason for all the things we just talked about, all the different databases you can go to, all the sources of information we threw you in your folder, you're going to get an advance notice of arrival, sorry, an ARAP that has a bunch of information on it that goes beyond the fisheries information. And we're focused initially on trying to confirm who this vessel really is. Is this vessel who it says it is? And once you can confirm that, then you can confirm if it is in fact that vessel, and that vessel is not on an IUU vessel list and not suspected of any IUU activity and not showing up on any RFMO list or Interpol purple notices or anything else, you're now going to assess your priority based on your own staffing, your ability to conduct an inspection in that day in that port. You could identify that as at low risk. So if everything's matching up, you've confirmed some of the information, you may have a low risk. Doesn't mean you won't board it, but you've set a risk. And we're going to talk in a little bit about risk assessment and how to use that to prioritize your boardings. Because very few of us, and I will applaud those in the room that I know are doing a phenomenal job on boarding as many vessels as they are that come in. But the agreement doesn't mandate that you board any set number of vessels. The agreement leaves it to the parties to determine whether they're board or don't board a vessel, with the exception of IUU vessels, right? Total exception. You let an IUU vessel in, you have to inspect it. But otherwise, it says to conduct a number of inspections to carry out the provisions of the agreement. Okay? So that's something definitely more than zero. You have to do some boarding inspection. But it also doesn't mandate that you must board 100% of the foreign flag vessels entering your ports, or 50%. It leaves that to you. But most of us can't board and inspect every vessel that comes in. And applause to those that are able to do that and to do a good job getting close to that number. So what we have to do is we have to prioritize. And that's this process of, do we have a high-risk vessel, low-risk vessel, or medium-risk vessel? So with that, I'm going to turn it back over to Catherine to talk a little bit about how we use risk assessment and boarding prioritization. And I think we're going to get some additional help from the expert in the back.
One of risk. Okay. So we've been talking about risk assessment this whole time. Okay? And over the course of the last couple of days, last 3 days, I guess it is now. So what we're looking at is really how likely is it that a vessel is compliant or non-compliant. When we're talking about IUU fishing and assessing risk, it's how likely is the vessel coming into your port an IUU vessel or suspect of IUU fishing. Brendan brought up a very good point, and some of you guys have with your questions in terms of there. And when Chow was explaining, in the RFMOs, typically vessels are listed at the annual meeting. But there's a lot of information that could be available before the actual listing event that shows that that vessel has either conducted or suspected of fishing illegally. So we kind of separate these in, to make it easy, a couple of different buckets, if you will, or pots. Okay? Is a vessel you see every time and it's normally compliant? Is it suspect of IU fishing or a known IU vessel? Okay, so all we're doing is trying to figure out, using all of the resources, well, not all of them, but using the resources Todd just provided and the examples we've shown and provided in the handouts, to collect information, compare information from more than one source that trusts but verify, okay, even if that source is your flag state, and then coming up with a system of how do we prioritize things. This, for the inspectors in the room, this is essentially what you're doing in some form or fashion every time you go on the docks, okay? This might be already your standard practice, but in addition to what Thailand presented, we don't all have a different company or assistants helping us with that risk assessment. So in the United States, we don't have OceanMind, but we have our analyst team. In many of your countries, it's up to you, the inspector, to be able to do some part of this. So we want to provide you with resources. So we're going to recap everything we've learned today as a first step. We should probably change this to Thailand, but it's a U.S. example. So outside, we have a vessel that we just got an AREP from, okay? It's seeking entry to port at the Sea Deck Training Center. What is the first thing we do? One of the first things we should do when we, to look into that vessel. Okay, one of the first steps, is it a listed vessel or is it not an IU listed vessel? Where do we go for that information again? What were some examples? Okay, an RFMO list. Okay, so the IUU list themselves. What were some other examples? Some of those consolidated lists, right, as a first step. So we talked about FAO had one, so where you could see if a vessel was authorized or listed in more than one RFMO. That TrigMat web link, and you guys are going to get all of these, okay? So looking at those resources. In addition to whether it's a known IUU vessel, what else, if it's not, what should you then check as a first step? Last port is good, but what specifically with the RFMOs, what are the two lists? The IUU list and the authorized vessels, okay? So we have a foreign flag fishing vessel. It's requested to come into the sea deck port. As a first step, and per the agreement, because as we talk, there's going to be specific actions you have to take on a known IUU vessel. We're going to check, is it or is it not an IUU vessel? Step two, is it authorized? Now, we've decided it's not an IU listed vessel. Can you stop there with that one check? Have you properly screened that vessel for IU fishing? Have you examined the AREP enough? No, not yet. Now we need to look at things like Todd just discussed. We can look at the IMO number, okay? We can look at last port of call. We can contact the flag state, okay? So now we're gonna look at the AREP. All of the information the vessel has provided, and we're gonna see, is there suspicion of IUU fishing. Okay? And part of this comes to the sources. Have you boarded this vessel before? Was there a violation? Okay? Is it a vessel with known violations? Did Malaysia contact Indonesia to say, this vessel fished illegally in my waters and it's headed your way? Did Singapore get a alert from the RPOA IUU that a vessel was headed into their port? Okay? So looking at multiple pieces now. Per the agreement, after the AREP is screened, we have to make a decision. Should the vessel be authorized to enter port or denied entry? Okay? So we receive the AREP. I'm giving up on the pointer. We received the AREP. We've now screened it. Now we have a decision to make to deny or enter. So if it's a vessel that's not on an IUU list, you've examined the AREP, maybe it's a vessel you see all the time, and you've determined there's no suspicion of IUU fishing, can you allow port entry? Sure, right? This is how we did it. So this row is becoming your risk assessment. What is your decision point? If the vessel was not an IUU vessel list, but Malaysia called Indonesia and said this vessel is coming your way, can you go back one slide? There. Malaysia called Indonesia, they fished my waters illegally, that catch is illegal. Should you deny vessel entry? If it's a suspect IUU fishing vessel. You could, but are you required to? That's one. Okay, we're gonna talk about that. If it's a known IUU vessel, can you allow it port entry? How many people say yes? Some thumbs up. Can you allow a known IU vessel into your port? Thumbs up for yes.
Gotta vote. One way or the other, everybody's gotta vote.
Do you deny port entry to a known IU vessel? Thumbs up or thumbs down? Got one thumbs down, got one thumbs up. If I have a blacklisted IU vessel, can it come into my port? How many thumbs up for yes? Blacklisted vessel, can it come into your port? Does it have to be denied entry? So, this comes down to how your country is going to implement. Per the Port State Measures Agreement, you can allow a known IUU vessel into your port for the purpose of inspection. If you do not inspect and you have to deny port services, this means they can't get fuel, they can't offload their catch, they can't fuel up, all those types of things. If you cannot provide a fisheries inspector or inspection team to go board that vessel, then you have to deny. From our perspective, we always advocate getting on that boat, taking pictures, conducting the inspection, okay? But for the agreement, there are specific requirements of how you must deal with a known or blacklisted IUU vessel. That's on one of those RFMO lists. You can either allow entry for inspection or deny.
No, I mean, I think there was a little bit of confusion in the group. So So, is that exception clear to everybody? Okay. Baseline requirement of the agreement, a known IUU vessel must be denied port entry and use of port services except for the purposes of law enforcement. So, you can allow a known IUU vessel to enter your port if you're going to inspect it. You can never allow a known IUU vessel to use port services. So even if you let them in to conduct an inspection, you can't allow them to use port services. And I probably should never say never, because then you've got the force majeure from that. They won't even get into that. Yes, sir.
See, one way we are trying to contain or curtail the list of IUU fishing vessels. So in that case, almost all the time shall not be allowed a port entry for an IUU listed vessel. Because you know that this particular vessel is engaged in IUU fishing, or rather blacklisted. In such a case, if they request, you can allow them entry, get it inspected, and detain them, that's it. So that you can reduce one number from the 250 or basis.
So, I mean, that part of that, part of your answer is going to depend on your national law. When you talk about detaining it, that would be subject to your national law. So if you know they're engaged in IUU, if they're a known and they're a listed IUU vessel under the agreement, you can allow entry only if you're going to conduct an inspection. And if you find... Now, if you have domestic law that allows you to take enforcement action, such as detain, arrest, you know, take custody of the vessel, then you can do that because it's under your national law. There's nothing in the agreement that tells you you can take action. The agreement doesn't give any country any new authority. You have your existing port authority. Port State Measures Agreement calls on all members, all parties, to effectively use their port authorities and Port State Measures capability to take action based on those. But it doesn't give you new authority. And so this seizing IUU vessels is much more complicated than. And often, I will say, you know, sometimes from the public perspective that doesn't deal with fisheries, or some of the NGO pitches, makes it sound very simple that the governments aren't doing enough. There's international law, so we don't actually have authority unless, you know, take action against a vessel that fished illegally in Tamil waters, for example. Singapore may not have any domestic authority to do anything, because they didn't violate any law of Singapore. In that case, they could still, they should, I would advocate, board, inspect, collect whatever evidence they can to feed back to the flag state, to the RFMO, and other members that may be able to take action, and ultimately you're simply denying it court services, sending it on its way after you've gathered whatever evidence you can. The agreement says you can't allow entry without taking that enforcement inspection.
So I just wanted to clarify one point. This is a U.S. example. And the reason why it says we would allow port entry for a suspect IUU fishing vessel is because we would want to allow it for the opportunity of an inspection. The agreement does say that if you have sufficient proof that a vessel seeking port entry has conducted IUU fishing activities, you can deny. But in our practices and implementation, we would allow vessel entry for inspection. So I just want to clarify that this is a U.S. example.
Yeah, I just want to add something based on my personal experience, is that if you detain or try to detain a vessel, which would be the ideal scenario, if we think primarily is that it's in my port, I'm going to seize it, it will never fish again. First, you have to have the law that allows you to do that. But even in that situation, what will happen is that they will challenge that decision. So there will be an appeal. In most countries, that will not be done in a week, which means that after 3 months, the crew leaves. And sometimes the crew becomes your responsibility. Because then we deny port service, but they claim the water for the vessel, it's vital because it's water for the crew. So, and this becomes a kind of a game that you have to give them food, you get, but then they don't pay the suppliers. Then the suppliers put pressure into collecting the debts. And then there is a commercial judge that decides that you can have a second seize on the vessel. And this ends up 10 years after the vessel being still rotting in some European ports. If you look at the NEAFC, NEAF, IUU list, you'll see that some of those vessels are in port since 2005 and since 2008 in Portugal and Spain. They're still there, rotting. I mean, they're not even good for scrapping anymore, but they're still in port. And then it creates another problem between you and the port authorities. Because legally they cannot move the boat. Most of it, if you move it, it will sink. It will become a problem for. So you have to balance these two things, which is, if it does not come to port, I'll avoid lots of problems, but then I will not get more information. So it has to be a balance between getting to port, inspect, and let it go. Some RFMOs are going the opposite direction, is that if it's already in IUU list, if you get it in, it will not go out. But then it creates other type of problems. So this, you have, and even if you are still at the drafting of your legislation level, you have to think about these things before you draft legislation. Because those are very high possibilities.
Do you mean to say that denying port entry is better than allowing port entry?
No. Actually, I...
No, but basically what I'm saying is that there are situations where one is better than the other. But you have to be very careful when, for instance, if, let's say that I have a vessel that is in an IUU list, but I search my sources and for the last 5 years, nobody added any information on that vessel. That's a very good opportunity for me to try to evaluate what the vessel has been done in the last 5 years, even if it's already listed. Now, if there is a permanent adding of information about that vessel, I'm not going to gain anything. And then again, it will be the call of the risk analysis group or even the inspector.
So, I think that the challenge, I mean, all good points to be considered. The bottom line is, as far as detaining, you've got to have legitimate national authorities do it. The vessel's in your jurisdiction because it's in your port. But your jurisdiction doesn't typically go toward, gee, I can seize this vessel for a violation of an RFMO conservation measure halfway around the world. It likely won't get you. And I think you have to evaluate some of the things that were mentioned, but you even want to do that in some cases. But some countries have national jurisdiction that would allow that. You may board and in the process find violations that are subject to your national law that would allow you to take action. And those are all positive things. Regardless, we're gathering more information, even if ultimately we have to send it on its way. I mean, the scenario that Joao raised wouldn't actually be able to happen like in the United States. I have a set period of time. I either make the case, I don't make the case. The court either says I can keep it or I can't. It isn't going to be years. It's going to be fairly short order that I've got to make my case for release the vessel. And so I think the scenario is just different. You have to look at your national law. But to say, IUU fishing is not a simple thing. It's not like they come into your waters, fish illegally in your zone. That's very clear. You can take all the action necessary, completely seize whatever you can do under national law. IUU committed somewhere else in someone else's jurisdiction becomes much murky.
And we have some unique tools, such as the Lacey Act that I mentioned to you, that allow for some violations of foreign law to be violations of U.S. law, which allows us to push that. And during the negotiations, this exception for law enforcement purposes is very important to us, and we pushed very hard with support of others, obviously. But that was something that we were very strong about, that we needed that exception. Because initially, the agreement, as it was being negotiated, the whole thing was, don't allow port entry. If you'd have your IOU vessels bouncing around the world just looking for, what is it called now, not ports of convenience?
Non-compliance.
So, sorry, to my FAA. Port of convenience is what I've been, it's in my head. So, port of non-compliance. So, everyone's different. It's just making sure that you understand in the agreement, must deny port entry to a known IOU vessel unless you're going to conduct an inspection, in which case you can allow entry, deny port services, conduct your inspection, either take law enforcement action based on international law, or send the vessel on its way, having gathered additional information. Your choice. We're advocating the allowing entry and boarding and inspecting. The agreement merely says you don't allow it in, you allow it in to inspect it. That's completely your decision.
So I would like to ask about the in the case of the if the vessel is suspect to IUU fishing, and so you will allow report entry for inspection. And in this case, if after inspection and then you cannot confirm that it's legal, so you will order the vessel to leave, or you can take any action for the vessel.
If
for U.S. the procedure.
Oh, in the U.S. Yeah. So I think as we understand the question, so if it came into the United States, it was suspected of IOU fishing, so we conduct an inspection. Our inspection does not yield evidence that supports the suspicion, or does it yield any violation of U.S. law, then we would, at that point, have to allow, or we could allow, port services and port entry, because there's the suspicion was not proof. There was no evidence that supported that suspicion. So that's how we would treat that. Did that answer your question?
So let's confirm again. So if the vessel comes, but you feel that suspicious, but you cannot find any evidence that's illegal, you can allow the use of port. And also it has to not contradict the U.S. law, I assume.
Yeah, if it's suspected, we suspect it of something, it comes in, we don't find any evidence that supports that suspicion, we would allow it to continue with port services. We haven't gotten to it, but under the agreement, we'll still share back with the flag state the results of our inspection. And maybe they'll see something in our inspection report. But if there's no violation of U.S. law and nothing that shows the suspicion is valid, then we allow it to continue. We just get our information and add it to the pile, and hopefully we can support suspicion down the road at least.
Thank you very much.
That's also why we would allow a suspect vessel to enter port, because we would want to be able to get on, collect that intelligence, collect that evidence, and see what the current situation is versus just denying a vessel.
Can I just...
Are you going to make this more complicated?
No. Actually, the no means yes.
You're the FAO, I understand.
No, is that you have to pay attention, because there is a little article, I'm not sure if it's 19 or 21, but it's around there, that guarantees the right to recourse, which means that the vessel's operator should be allowed to challenge your decisions. And that is very important. So even if your law has to be strong enough to give you the powers to refuse entry, deny entry, in the name of the legal process, I think you call it, how do you call it?
Due process.
You have to allow the vessel operator to challenge your decision. Why are you refusing or denying the entry to port? And they may start a legal procedure against that, challenging that decision. So you have to keep also those things in mind, is that it may be a simple decision, but it, in some legal regimes, it can be complicated. In some, I would say some legal frameworks is quite simple to deal with this. Some others, it may be lengthy. And especially if there is a lot of money in the vessel, if there is a high value product, and if the vessel operators are economically powerful, then they will challenge your decision.
And that's a good one. There is a recourse section, but I mean, so I'm going to try to simplify it again, maybe oversimplify it. But I mean, from our perspective, I mean, you make sure your domestic law allows you the authority to do whatever you do. At least under our system, we can be challenged on virtually anything we do. But the goal is you simply do it in accordance with the law, and 99 times out of 100, they will lose that fight. Let them fight that. But as long as my law, the goal here is to ensure you know what the agreement says, hopefully your laws completely implement and support the agreement, and that if they do raise, as long as you're acting in accordance with your law, ideally there won't be any problem, and yes, they can appeal your decision to deny port services or whatever, but the reality is as long as you're doing it in accordance with your law and you're acting in good faith, generally it's going to be okay under any of our systems. In general, I don't want to oversimplify, but also from the inspector level, simply need to do things, you gather your evidence, you do things in accordance with your law, and that probably doesn't involve, like, if it's not a violation of your law, it won't be necessarily a vessel seizure. Maybe conducting an inspection. For us, I can detain a vessel long enough to conduct my investigation. Within reason. If I claim that I've got to detain this vessel for a month so I can investigate, that will not fly in the United States. Okay? A reasonable period of time. I may be able to delay a vessel. But you'll see in the agreement too, it talks about without undue delay, right? So you can't just hold the vessel and inspect it for weeks on end with no basis. Okay?
I think we'll cover that in the next presentation.
So just a lot of the pieces. Yes.